as we seek to understand what God is saying to us this day. Turn first of all to Psalm 67. Listen now for God's word as recorded. May God be gracious to us. It is our prayer, isn't it? And bless us and make his face to shine upon us. That your way may be known upon the earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all peoples praise you. Let the earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him. And then the text for what I'm going to speak with you about in just a little while comes from Hebrews, the 13th chapter, beginning at the very first verse. I love the way that the author gives us these helpful ways to live the Christian life. So many are asking that question these days. How do I live the Christian life? And just pay attention to these 15 verses and you get a good idea. Let mutual love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, or for by doing that, some have entertained angels without knowing them. Remember those who are in prison, as though you were in prison with them. Those who are being tortured, as though you yourselves were being tortured. Let marriage be held in honor by all. Let the marriage bed be kept undefiled, for God will judge fornicators and adulterers. Keep your lives free from the love of money. It doesn't say anything about having possessions. It talks about loving your possessions and money. And be content with what you have. And he has said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? Remember your leaders, he goes on. Those who spoke the word of God to you, consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, tomorrow, or forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings, for it is well for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by regulations about food, which have not benefited those who observe them. We have an altar from which those who officiate in the tent have no right to eat. The bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. Therefore, Jesus also suffered outside the city gate in order to sanctify the people by his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp and bear the abuse he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. This is probably the thrust of what I'll be speaking about today. Through him, then, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of the lips that confess his name. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Loving God, we're asking now that your spirit that we already claim to be present in the Reformed tradition might open our hearts and minds to ponder these words, to think about what you have to say to us today. Christ our Lord, we pray. Amen. Well, the Presbyterian Church USA, you know, we all have comments about our wonderful church, good, bad, but I'm telling you, they have taken care of me. Several years ago, the Presbyterian Church discovered something was happening to their pastors. They were given this clue from the Episcopalian Church, as a fair number of Episcopalian pastors were dying at the age of 55. Presbyterians did some research. They found the same is happening among their pastors. and an inordinate number of us were dying at 55. So what they decided to do was start working on the problem. And one of the solutions was to start a program called CREDO, C-R-E-D-O. CREDO invites a group of pastors, about 30, to retreat in the mountains of North Carolina at a camp and conference center for about a week. It's not an annual event. It is a career event. It's going to happen once for you if you're a pastor. And at that event, they will have doctors there to assess your medical health. They'll have financial planners, retirement specialists. They'll have a psychologist or two for those of us that are having a few problems, dealing with issues, so to say. They'll have directors for your spiritual health. It's quite a program. Well, I was informed that I had been chosen to go a few years back. And I arrived on Sunday, midday. The events would begin with a happy hour Sunday evening. How many times did the church have a happy hour? But there was a happy hour Sunday evening. And I was, again, there well in advance, so I thought, you know what, I'll just go down to the conference center for a little while and talk. Because I knew who was going to be there, and I recognized some names on the list, and I thought, well, I'll talk for a little while. But the more I thought about that, the more I didn't want to do it. I don't know what it was. I think I was tired. So I just stayed in my room. But that wasn't getting it either. My spirit was weary. Pastors have a hectic schedule, probably like a lot of you. And some of our spirits can get weighed down from time to time because you deal with a lot of suffering and loss and trouble. And I was somewhat sad. So I thought, well, you know what, I'm going to take a walk. So I walked outside, and I happened to see a sign that said, Nature Walk. I thought, hey, there it is, waterfall included. So I walked silently, picking my way over some trees that had fallen on the path and moving around some boulders, and eventually came to an outcropping of rock that kind of was a vista point. I could see the beauty of God's good creation. And truth be told, I simply sat there for a little while and reveled in the glory of the canyon that was before me. And what happened next was difficult to put into words, but I started thinking instantly of the Psalms. I had memorized some. Psalm 8, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. Psalm 121, I lift up my eyes to the hills, from where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And you know, it wasn't long before a spirit of adoration and celebration was beginning to rise up within me. Thanksgiving poured forth not only from my surroundings, but it started to pour forth from me. I thought of our first hymn in the hymn book. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Quiet murmurings of reverence continued within me for some time. There seemed to be some listening on my part to the stillness of God's creation. Quietness had a voice, and it was speaking. It wasn't long before I had to get back, you know. Happy hour was on the agenda. And in thinking about it just a bit, the rest of the day, and even into the following days, I had discovered something. That going out into God's good creation, I had communed with God. And I had been helped, even though I had asked for none. I had entered a loving adoration that soothed my sorrows and drew me nearer to God. Perhaps the same thing has happened to you. I don't know. Today, I'm going to use that story as a jumping off point because we're going back to the beginning of our summer excursion here in these summer months at First Pres Valpo and pick up this theme of prayer once again. Our prayers take place in a variety of settings and a variety of ways. The good news I share to you with you today is that God responds. See, I think it happened in the mountains of North Carolina way back when, as I had issued a form of a prayer and discovered the important piece in it. That it wasn't a continual listing of all the things that I needed God to do for me. God had answered many of my prayers as I praised God and thanked God for who God is, all that God has done. Today we pick up the priority of praise and thanksgiving and look at the monumental role it plays in an effective prayer life. Some of this is coming from Richard Foster's book on prayer. If you haven't got the book, get it. I'm sure it's in our library. He picks up this theme of praise and thanksgiving and titles it Prayer of Adoration. He gives it a complete chapter. In it, he says, you thank God for all that God has done in your life, and you praise God for who God is. Same coin, being prayer of adoration, two sides of it. The distinction's valid. Prayer of thanksgiving can be all about me. Lord, I thank you for all that you've done for me. But in the Old Testament, the world that in that day is kind of soaked with both of these. Prayer of praise and prayer of thanksgiving. I cite to you today the days of King David, where certain priests followed the Ark of the Covenant. And those priests were given one function, to invoke, to thank, to praise the Lord God of Israel. In Leviticus, we discover that there was a thank offering at every Jewish worship service. In the Psalms, well, it's hard to find a psalm that doesn't have the words praise or thanksgiving in it. Psalm 106, oh, give thanks to the Lord. Psalm 91, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. And then when you consider Jesus in the New Testament, you discover his grateful nature before God is one of prayer and thanksgiving. They were signature signs of his prayer life. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, Jesus would say. Same thing he said of Paul. And today, my thrust is to simply encourage you today to consider this notion, perhaps develop this sense of thanksgiving and praise in your prayer life if it isn't already there. If you're like me, I used to be one that would simply list all the things that I needed God to do for me. Our text comes from Hebrews. Most of us don't spend much time here, but it's a rich source of help for the Christians. The writer of Hebrews really don't know who he is. But he urges us today. I have loved his words in this 15th verse of that 13th chapter. Let us, he says, continually offer a sacrifice of praise. On the surface, that sounds like pretty good advice, doesn't it? Give God praise. That's how I translate it when I'm quickly reading the Bible. But I have loved to go deeper into this. I have loved it. It is so rich. When the writer of Hebrews mentions, let us, when he writes sacrifice of praise, he's got much to say that he's not saying. He's using that injunction, let us, to get us going, not paying attention to everything that's happened in the past, but to get us moving forward. Words of encouragement, words of togetherness. You know, when I use the words let us, as a basketball coach and a volleyball coach, I would say, let us play good defense. Let us play good offense. Let us go to digging, setting, and killing in volleyball. When I used those words, I was calling the team to move forward and do this. I wasn't saying anything about the past. I'm just saying, let's do this. At session meetings, I say, let us stay positive. That's encouragement to everybody. When I lead worship, I say, let us worship God. I'm hoping the body, the congregation, those in attendance will worship the Lord. Let us is an injunction for us not to dwell on the past, but to move forward. And the writer of Hebrews is asking you today to move forward in your prayer life. But he also mentions this sacrifice of praise. And that, if you do a little bit of work with it, harkens back to the days of Jesus, the Day of Atonement, causing us to remember that Jesus, if you recall in the text, did not die in the temple, in the Holy of Holies, where a holy man should have died. He was thrown outside the city gates, a place where they threw dead animals. If your dog died, that's where you threw your animal. Where your trash was sent, that's where you put it outside the city gates, where the criminals were executed for not following the law. This is where Jesus was sent. And the writer of Hebrews says, listen, my friends, your Savior who died for you was sent there. This Son of God was placed in the midst of terribleness and rescue you from everything that is outside that city gate. The writer is hoping that you'll recall that, because that should help you understand the depths from which you have come and the life that you now have in abundance today. The writer says, can you not continually offer a thanksgiving, a praise for where God has brought you, a person deserving to be outside the city gates, sinful, and brought you into God's wonderful love, God's wonderful chosenness, and God's wonderful eternal life? What is happening in this text? The writer is asking you to remember the depths from which you have risen, because it makes you appreciate more the place in which you reside. You know, I take a shower every day. I got a response at the 8 o'clock, because I'll tell you that myself. Yeah, but it's rather ho-hum. I'm here to say to you, it's rather ordinary for me. I turn on the hot water aspect of the shower. I wait for the water to heat up. I soak up. I rinse. I dry off. It's rather ordinary. I don't appreciate it very much. However, when I'm on a mission field in Africa, and I'm at a church conference for 4 days in the bush with no showers, when I get a shower for the very first time, it, my friends, is heavenly. I bask in a shower. The writer of Hebrews is asking you to do the same in recalling the depths from which God has taken you into the abundant life that you live right now. Can that not cause you to offer a prayer of thanksgiving and praise to God for all that God has done for you? A lot of you know, I think my dog better than more than you know me. We have Zoe, a little black lab at home, a rescue lab. Our first rescue lab, a first rescue animal of any sorts. And the one thing about Zoe that continues to impress me is that she has a tendency to be very appreciative of everything that we do for her. She's thankful to have a bed. She's thankful to have a bone from time to time. She's thankful that someone pets her, because she was beaten as a dog in an apartment by a woman who did not know that labs were going to be as boisterous as they are. Zoe seems to appreciate things more because she knows from where she has come. By her fears, is hoping you'll pick this up. I hope he hopes you know where you have come from. It's reminding us to appreciate the life that we have today, the spiritual vitality that belongs to us through the workings of the Holy Spirit. For you have risen from the depths of sin and darkness that your Savior took upon himself to give you a life of vitality. And in addition, the writer goes on, God has given you good things to enjoy today. Can that now cause you to respond with an attitude, they say, of gratitude and thanksgiving for your many blessings? Take stock, he says today, all that God has given you, because you have immeasurably more than the Bible says you deserve. When we consider the church, for example, do you know that pavilion service is simply stunning? That pavilion is wonderful. To experience the beauty of God's good creation on Sunday morning is absolutely stunning to me. I was competing with a crow this morning, and I think I won. But the 9 o'clock service, look at the beauty of this place that God has provided. Through all the saints that have gone before you, the stained glass windows, the pipe organ, and a building that's paid for. Can you not worship in a spirit of thanks and praise? Or the 11 a.m. service, the praise band, some like it, some don't. A Presbyterian church across the line, I've seen them. Presbyterian churches die for that stuff. And you've got it all. And that's just this church. That's just some of the aspects of this church. I think about my personal life. If you would have told me that I would have at 56 the blessings that I have available, the financial resources alone, along with 2 beautiful children and a beautiful wife, I would say, somebody pinched you. And I bet the same is true for each of you. I wonder sometimes, though, why I complain. But I do. I'm good at it. I'm actually quite marvelous at it. And these obstacles, these things that I think about and I revert back to, cause me to get out of this thankfulness and praise of God. And one aspect that I have trouble with the most is busyness. C.S. Lewis wrote, "It's so easy to get caught up in this world of life and miss the divine overtures of love. It's not," he says, "that we're trapped in this rat race of acquiring things." He says, "It's quite legitimate demands of home and family and school and work that conspire to make life a blur and help us forget about our blessings. Like Jack and the beanstalk, our obligations seem to grow overnight." Well, the writer of Hebrews says, listen, if that's the environment in which you live, don't let your opportunity to give God thanks and praise be crowded out of those things that are consuming your life. You want some of your problems in life taken care of. Go out and commune with your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and give him thanks and praise, and you'll find that a lot of your problems have a tendency to get solved and taken away. But it's not just our busyness, it's also our focus. We hear a baby crying in church. It happened about 3 weeks ago. You should have seen the people look at that mother with her crying child. I can say the words, "Shut that child up. Don't you know this is worship?" But is it not a blessing to have babies in churches? I wonder what God's response would be to a crying baby in church. Or we have that, oh my goodness, that person who is off key singing a hymn. How irritating can it be? Once again, the writer of Hebrews encourages us to redirect our thoughts. Let us, he says, focus on God. Thank God for God's many blessings. Offer our praise for all that God has done. Obstacles, we've all got them. But that's not necessarily the entire point behind the Hebrew writer's writings. He would say, let us continue to offer our praise, our sacrifice of praise. How do we do this? I think it's actually learned, some of it. Adoration is learned. There seems to be some stepping stones involved in becoming people who can give praise and give thanks. And one of them is not by thinking about it. Presbyterians are noted as great thinkers. But you can't think about praise. You experience praise. As you experience a butterfly, as you witness the opening of a flower, as you view Lake Michigan on the morning in which you rose, as you view God's creation from a scenic overlook, it is there that something wells up within us. Have done for me. It happened to me in the hills of North Carolina. It happened to me on a walk yesterday with Toby. You go to a brook, and you splash the water on your face, and you simply let the water refresh you. And you sit back and you notice the brook. You notice and feel the breeze. You watch the leaves. Your response is thank you. Some people think you're losing your mind. But I would argue you are beginning to appreciate more fully the blessings that God has given you through His Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's a stepping stone. Taking time to be mindful. Taking time to appreciate beauty, God's created beauty. Second thing too, and this has something to do with worship, this kind of can rub Presbyterians the wrong way, Methodists too, Episcopalians probably in this group as well, that worship is not to be stale. It is to be life-giving. It is to be joyous. God has forgiven you of your sins today. That is reason to rejoice. God has heard your prayers of concern. And that should cause you to stand up and to sing. Hallelujah. It should cause you in singing a hymn not to mumble, but even to sing with your heart. As if God is the only one witnessing your praise. Something needs to well up within us. Because if you're not going to do it, Scripture says the rocks will. Heaven, as Revelation, kind of gives you some hints from time to time, is worshipful. Most people would say, I'm in what place? A great big golf tournament. I'm going to be playing the golf courses of heaven. Couldn't have it more wrong from the different ideas found throughout Scripture. In heaven, the angels are leading the worship and praise of our Lord and King, Jesus Christ. So today, I'm going to leave you with something. I'm going to ask you to actually do something this week. I want you to look and examine the way in which you give thanks and praise to God. Could you be like Miriam in the Old Testament that gives praise to her Lord and King, for he has thrown the horse and rider into the sea? Could you be like Mary and praise the author of creation for all that God has done? This week, amid all the problems, amid all the difficulties that we will hear of a world that is unraveling, where violence is the way that you deal with problems, could you be different? Give God thanks for what God has done in your life, but even more importantly, could you give God thanks for who God is? Author, creator, sustainer, king. Let's pray. Loving God, we must admit, from time to time, we just don't get it right. Of course, the witness of Scripture is that we'll never get it right. But we're grateful that you are there. And that as you consistently give us the sunrise and the sunset, as you give us the nurturing, life-giving rays of heaven, so instill upon your people today and in the days to come, a spirit of thankfulness, a spirit of adoration, and then help them as well to take that next step and to respond by giving of their time, talent, and their resources so that the church might flourish, that this message might be proclaimed through Christ our Lord.